we had a major problem on the road, but at least we were able to make it. I would like to introduce Dr. David Linke from Berlin. Dr. Linke studied chemistry and technical chemistry in Cologne and later in the Technical University in Berlin. And he is, since I think 4 years, active working on combinatorial chemistry at the Institute of Applied Chemistry in Berlin. And he is heading the Department of Engineering. So I think combinatorial chemistry becomes more and more important. And just recently, a major project was launched by Exxon and Cymex. Maybe you read about that, $250 million going into that. So it becomes more and more important, especially the group in Berlin is, from what I know, somewhat unique. They apply some evolutionary algorithm in the catalyst development, and that is something quite new and not widely applied. And I'm really pleased that Dr. Linke will give us some information on that. Please.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the kind introduction. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is a pleasure for me to have this talk in front of you and to show you some results that we have obtained in the combinatorial catalyst development at the ACA. We studied working on that subject approximately 5 years ago, and I'm involved nearly since the beginning of the work. I have to express my acknowledgments to my colleagues, Uwe Rodemer. He is the leader of the group High Throughput Experimentation. Then Martin Molenia, he's a specialist for information technology from Prague. So we have Stefan Kolf for preparation, Dorit Wolf, she created this evolutionary algorithm, it was her idea. And then Olga Gruevskaya previously worked in our group, and then she retired and got a daughter. And Manfred Berns was a professor in the Institute, director of the Institute, and was also the man who pushed this forward, high throughput experimentation in our Institute. So he was convinced from the beginning. I will have the following topics in my presentation. First, I like to say a few words about our Institute. Then I will speak in more detail about the evolutionary approach for catalyst optimization. And finally, give some examples where it makes sense to apply artificial neural networks in this combinatorial catalyst optimization approach. So this is where we are. So Berlin is in the eastern part of Germany, nearly isolated, no bigger city around it, so compared to other regions in West Germany. And so in Berlin, we have a focus of universities there. We have different parts, so all these red points here are universities or research centers. The part where we are, it's here, this campus. This is a new campus on Eastern Berlin part. It was the former institute of the Eastern, of the former GDR, of the Eastern part of Germany, where all the research that has been done in chemistry and catalysis was centered at one point. And the institute arose from these former institutes. So this is the campus. It's a large campus. And all research institutes and small companies dealing with research and producing equipment for research. We have also a synchrotron facility here for advanced X-ray absorption or XPS methods. And okay, we are quite close to the synchrotron. We have an old building, but it's still okay, not so nice. But it's good. So, the concept of our institute is that we want to do applied research in catalysis, and therefore we have certain topics which we deal with. We have part catalytic reaction engineering, where we have different reactors, mini plant equipment, and also microstructured reactors. Then we have catalytic reactions, where we, in this part, we want to find new ways to produce chemicals and catalytic using catalytic reactions. We have catalyst preparation, analysis, mainly catalyst characterization, but also analysis of reaction mechanisms. And we have mathematic modeling, mainly modeling reaction kinetics, modeling reactors, and evaluating process schemes. So this is just the concept of the whole institute, but it's not its organization. I have one slide about that. So we just got a new scientific director, Professor Vance, who was the former director, retired in June, and our new director will be Dr. Dingerdissen. He's coming from the industry. He works formerly at BASF and Degussa and Hoechst, so he's quite experienced. And then we have three departments: one, catalytic processes and catalysts, enabling technologies, and characterization. I don't have to go through that in detail. This one called enabling technologies, that is now led by me, and there we have group combinatorial catalyst development, catalytic reaction engineering, and the third group dealing with inorganic membranes and membrane reactors. And the whole institute has about 100 to 110 employees. So now let's come to the main topics of my talk. I want to introduce you to this evolutionary approach to catalyst optimization. So the main problem in the library design for systematic optimization of catalysts is that you have to test two huge numbers of catalysts to really study the whole parameter range. So for example, if you have 50 chemical elements and you want to analyze all binary combinations of them, then you have to do 1,200 tests without any concentration changes. So just mix two of the components. And if you want to mix three, you go to 20,000 components. And if you then think of different concentration levels or different reduction pretreatments, calcinations, and so on, you come to unhandleable large numbers of combinations. And this is called this combinatorial explosion. So, and that made us thought about another way to approach the problem. And then we came up with an evolutionary strategy. So here's once again the need shown, or the difference between combinatorial catalysis and combinatorial chemistry, as it is usually known. So in heterogeneous catalysis, we have even more complex problems than in the normal combinatorial chemistry. And that is because catalysts are much more complex than biomolecules. We have extra parameters since that are multi-component oxides, they are non-stoichiometric. And we have to deal also with support effects. We have a surface, and on the surface is something placed, and so we have much more factors which influence a catalyst as a system than compared to a molecule. Also, testing is much more difficult compared to these combinatorial chemistry in biotechnology. We have to evaluate activity, selectivity, stability, space-time here is the same as activity, and also they all depend on the reaction conditions, and that makes the problem much more difficult than in biology or in biochemistry. And this clearly shows that we need some special methods. In general, you can approach this combinatorial process quite systematic combinations, and I have shown you that that is not really the way to go, because you need too many experiments. You can do only a stochastic search in the whole parameter space, but then you will not use any information that you get from your experiments. And so what is the right way to do is to do an optimization procedure, to integrate an optimization procedure in this combinatorial process. And different optimization procedures may be in principle used. We can use common optimization procedures similar as simplex algorithms also for a local search, but they are only can be only applied to local search. So, and if we want to do a global search in the parameter space, we have to look for different algorithms, and one of these algorithms, class of algorithms, are the genetic algorithms. And that's the road that we choose. So, what do we, or what do we understand and know about the evolution? So our idea was to learn from nature, and in nature, within the evolution, there is an optimization by natural selection and adaption. So in the beginning, we have a mixed pool of different frogs in this example, and only green frogs will survive in a green environment, and so from year to year, the green frogs will dominate the evolution. And how is this optimization handled by nature? So this green, or the color of the frog is determined by the genotype, so by the genes, which have all the information about the frog inside. And so then there happen different changes of the genes. We can differentiate between crossover and mutation. So with crossover, we have two parents with different genotypes, and they exchange a certain gene, and then the color of the frog will change if these genes determine the color. So this is the mechanism of crossover, and we also have a mechanism of mutation where just one gene is changed by, for example, radiation, and then we also can come to a different frog that might be green and might survive. And these very simple basic ideas we try to apply in catalysis. So we had to design an evolutionary algorithm where the catalyst composition is encoded in these genes. We had to define this crossover and mutation operators, and we have to define some kind of selection and reproduction function. And I will talk about this and then later on give some examples for the application of this approach. Okay, this work was originally published by Dorit Wolf and Olga Bujarskaya already in 2000, and then it was modified again and again, but the original idea was published in 2000. And also patented. So we have a patent about this methodology. So in the beginning, so I want to talk about how we encode the catalyst composition in kind of genes. So we have different variables that must be encoded. First, it's the composition. So we have an element that might be present or might be not. So here we have a expression if it's 0 or 1, depending on if the element is in the catalyst or not. And we also have a fraction of the element. So we have two genes here. One string that describes the presence of the components, and another string that describes the presence or the amount of the components. But we cannot only encode, or we should not only encode the composition of the catalysts, but also different other variables that are known to influence the catalytic properties, like mode of various preparation steps. And in the easiest way, we encode it as different numbers. So we have different variants of preparation, and we assign a different value to each of the variables. So now I have shown you how we can encode the catalyst in kind of a gene. And now we have to define our operators, how a mutation or a crossover, a change of the catalyst can happen. So here is now the mutation shown. And then we have here this former catalyst, the parent. And then it gets mutated, and then we come to the children. And the mutation takes place at one position of the gene. So that is the gene of the catalyst. It might also take a place at two positions. That is a parameter that can be selected in the optimization. The other procedure, how information is transferred from the parent generation to the children. It's the crossover mechanism. Here we have the parents on the left-hand side, and they exchange a certain gene here at this position. So now the one child has included the indium, and the other one lost it. And it's the same with the cobalt. Cobalt is exchanged as well. So we have two points of crossover in this crossover procedure. And this, where this crossover happens, is determined randomly in the optimization algorithm. And also, if we choose one or two crossover points, is a parameter in the algorithm. And then we have evaluated then different values and integrated that into our algorithm, and it turns out that it's enough to have one or two crossover points optimization. So here this whole procedure, the design of the evolutionary algorithm for the catalyst development is shown in one slide. So at the beginning of the optimization, we have to define a pool of elements, and as we have to define an objective function as well. Do we want to optimize for conversion, for selectivity, for yield, or space-time yield, or so? If that is clear, then we will generate a catalyst, a first generation of catalysts, and this is a done by randomization. This initial generation of catalysts, maybe 50 different kind of samples, will be tested and prepared and tested with a high throughput equipment. And then we get a ranking of the quality of the catalysts that we created in the first generation. And for the ranking, we use the objective function. And based on the ranking of the catalysts, these mutation operators are applied. And the higher the ranking of a catalyst, the more the higher the probability that it gets that it can give information to the children. So we have so there's a high probability that catalysts of certain quality levels give their information to other catalysts within this generation, and thereby we can generate even better catalysts. So that's the idea behind it. So we are here at this point where we have selected the catalysts for reproduction by their ranking. Then we generate the next generation with these crossover and qualitative and quantitative mutation operators. Then we do again the parallel synthesis and testing, and we do this loop again and again until we see or we are satisfied with the results. And here on the right hand side, if there's an example shown, here is the value of the objective function, and the value of the objective function from generation 1 to generation 20. And what is shown is one, the best value in red, and the mean value. So the longer the generation runs, the simpler the catalysts will be within the whole generation. So in the beginning, you generate very different samples, and in theory, the longer the evolution runs, the similar they will become. But it might take a long while, a long while. So this causes that the mean and the best, they converge. But you will never reach this in reality. So this is a pseudo experiment that was used to define certain parameters of the algorithm. Now I want to come to example of this algorithm. The reaction where this algorithm was applied first was the oxidative dehydrogenation of propane to propene. And we begin with a definition of the components that are used within the evolutionary approach. And we do that by looking first at the scientific background. So we think about the reaction mechanisms that might take place and that will lead to oxidative propane dehydrogenation. And there are different mechanisms known. So this reaction can happen via a redox mechanism where there's active lattice oxygen in the oxidic catalyst. Then it can run via adsorbed oxygen, where adsorbed oxygen activates the alkane, and it might also run above or with lattice oxygen involved, but without a redox mechanism. So, and for all these three mechanisms, there are certain elements known which can catalyze or which have. Whether catalytic reaction runs with this mechanism. So we set up our first generation based on these mechanistic thoughts. And we choose vanadium, molybdenum, manganese, iron, and these components are known to allow these mechanisms that I've shown before. Moreover, we looked at the metal oxygen binding energy, which should be in a certain range. Okay, and now I show you how this approach was run further. So we have prepared or selected the first generation of catalysts, and here are the results shown. So within the first generation, we only got a very low yield of propane, and then from generation to generation we got an increase. So that is only a small fraction of the whole generation. We had a larger generation of 50 samples, and this is just the top of the generation. So what is the main purpose of this plot is to show just that this evolution really proceeds forward, so you can really go forward relatively fast from generation to generation. So this is a larger plot. I wonder. I thought. Okay. I think that was a project. So here, in principle, this is the same. Same result, but with more samples from a second evolution. So here we had, in principle, two evolutions running. And the first one was with these elements only selected. And then, that is the plot that I've shown you. And then after that, we saw that we have to add more components to the pool to proceed any far further. And then we added a basic metal oxide, an acidic metal oxide, and a metal oxide on which the oxygen dissociates. And this is this allows the different reaction mechanism that I've shown before. And now here on this slide is the result from the second evolution, where we integrated the different supports which allow the different kind of oxygen activation. And okay, here we have come to much higher yields than in the previous approach. From the proceeding from generation to generation, you can learn a little bit by looking at how the catalysts are composed within the generation. So in the first generation, all the elements are nearly randomly distributed, and then from generation to generation, certain elements turn out to be bad. This is lanthanum and bor. Some turn out to not influence the catalytic behavior. This is iron and manganese. And some are really necessary for the catalytic activity. And since they are so important for a catalytic activity, they dominate the generation. By this crossover and mutation, they come to more and more of the children.
They dominate it.
So, these samples, this is the best result from the generation. They were analyzed then with characterization techniques to learn more what caused the higher activity of these catalysts. So these are top candidates from the generations. And we also characterized some similar materials that we have formerly studied in our laboratory to get an idea what influences the what is the real reason for activity in propane dehydrogenation. And we have analyzed the magnesium to vanadium content of the surface, and also and plotted this via the yield as a function, or we plotted the yield of propene as a function of the ratio of manganese to vanadium in these catalysts. And it turned out that there's a correlation between this ratio and the yield. And this means that we really should have dispersed vanadium species to cause the activity of the catalyst. And by knowing this, we redesigned the catalyst in a more scientific approach, and we thought about which systems can be used which really allow us to have highly dispersed active vanadium species. So here are once again the results from the evolutionary procedures. First, this initial evolution where I've shown only four generations, and we saw an increase of the propene yield. And these are the components in this first evolution which are dominant. And then we ran this second evolution, which allows us to proceed a little bit further. And by characterization, we have identified that isolated vanadium species are important for the activity. So we learned also something about the function of the catalyst by doing this approach and combining it with the characterization. So, and now we come to the point where we added the scientific knowledge to the approach, and we had made some catalysts where we used MCM 48 as a support material, and on this support we have a highly dispersed vanadium, and this really brings us a step change in the activity or entropy in yield. So what I wanted to show is that the evolutionary approach might not also help you in optimizing a catalyst within certain boundaries, but by analyzing the best samples that can be identified from the pool, and by trying to understand what causes their activity, you can really come to new conclusions from scientific point of view and perhaps change to a totally different system. Now I come to another example. Something different that was done for industry, for Ligusa. We had to find new catalysts for production for HCN from methane and ammonia. And this approach was really very successful. I cannot show details of this because we are just allowed to present a rough overview. So in the beginning of this catalyst optimization, we had very good success. So what is shown here, first is a reference sample from Ligusa in this yellow one, and then here are the best values, so the best catalyst in a generation and the mean value, so mean above all catalysts in the generation. And what you see here is that we even got a better performing catalyst in the initial generation. That is okay luck, good luck, or we were happy to have that, but we were able to proceed, so we got to better and better catalyst within this optimization procedure, and we could really show that this procedure is very useful for the catalyst optimization. In this example, we had a generation size of 92, and so this was 7 times 92, 640 samples approximately that were tested within this approach. This slide shows once again how far or how the evolution proceeds. What is shown here is the yield of nitrogen within this process, that's the undesired product, and the yield of HCN. So, and the better you are, so the more you come to the right side. And here's the point from the reference catalyst. So, and in the first generations, if you look, we had one sample that has a high activity that was better than the reference sample, and the second one that was close to the reference sample, but most of these systems were relatively bad. And in the seventh generation, we had a lot of samples which are better than the reference catalysts. And these samples are not totally the same. So you get a pool of samples which have a high activity. And this opens good opportunities for patenting. So they do not get one reference composition that is better than the state of the art, so, but they get a pool of combinations that can be all claimed at once. And so they cover a higher or a larger area in the patents that arise from this. So that might be one other aspect in this evolution. You will not come to one system if there's more than one that is good. So then you come to a pool of systems which might be different, but which have a similar yield or similar value in your objective function. So here, this reaction for Ligusa. So the HCN production is a reaction at a very high temperature, and there we had a special reactor constructed. So the reaction runs at 1150 degrees C, so extremely high temperature. And here is shown the gas distribution via capillaries And here at the bottom is a reactor with ceramic tubes, as reactor tubes, and it's heated by a ceramic coil of a heating wire wound above a ceramic element. This equipment was our sequential analytics are used in this equipment, so we had an online IR detector here, and then all the data are connected with control software. It was run unattendedly. That's also very important in high throughput. I could show you perhaps some better examples where we applied this algorithm, but the problem is that nearly everything is still confidential where we applied these. So we have tested where we have applied the algorithm to different reactions. We have studied the oxidative dehydrogenation of ethane to ethylene. That is also open, but that's the same approach as the propane oxidation, so that's nothing different. Then we have a low temperature total oxidation of hydrocarbons, where propane should be removed from air for air separation units. We have selective hydrogenation in gas phase. We have low temperature water gas shift reaction, Enox and hydrogenolysis reaction. And so we have a lot of experience now with this algorithm, and it is always very effective. I want to draw some intermediate conclusions from the evolutionary strategy. These algorithms are very useful optimization tools if you have no information on the topology of the parameter space, and this is the case in catalyst optimization. And moreover, the parameter space is very large, and so this is a global search that must be used, and evolutionary algorithms are global search algorithms. These algorithms are moreover quite robust, and they can be applied very universally. So we optimize within one algorithm discrete and continuous values. So we have the discrete value, is the catalyst in the catalyst or is it not? And we have also discrete values in the preparation procedures. And we have also continuous variables like the concentration. And what is a very important aspect in the high throughput testing is that this concept that you have a generation and go from one generation to the next one is compatible to the array concept of the parallel testing. So you have to suggest 50 next samples every time you have done or you have completed one experiment, you have to suggest the next 50 or next 100 depending on your array size. So you need also an algorithm which is compatible with the whole testing procedure. So now I want to come to a second part of my talk, to the application of artificial neural networks. So why can artificial neural networks be useful in combinatorial catalysis? They are good for this data analysis part. Because they will allow you a description of your parameter space. And with neural networks, you can describe any kind of parameter space, and no matter what is the form of this space. And this is done by establishing relationships between, you can establish complex relationships between composition and performance without that you have to make any assumptions on the function. And after you have established these relationships by determining your neural network parameters, then you can use the neural network to extract knowledge of this parameter space. So the basic idea is that we, from our experiment, got some points in the parameter space, and we want to find a function which covers a larger space than we have covered with the experiments. And neural networks can be used for this. Artificial neural networks are as well inspired by a biological concept where we have neurons that compose the neural systems. And they are applied in signal and information processing. In this architecture of the neural networks, we discriminate between neurons, connections, and layers. And the whole architecture is called the perceptron. And I'll show you a picture of that, and then it can be better explained. So, for example, we have the output that should be the yield of propane. That's what we want to describe. And we have the parameters that influence the yield of propane in this example. And so the input to the neural network, the input layer will be the components and the fraction of the components. And the output of the neural network will be the yield of the protein. And the connections between input layer and the output layer is made via functions that pass the information. And it turns out that a neural network has to contain also hidden layers. So it would be possible to directly connect the input to the output, but that is not flexible enough to describe complex parameter spaces. So you have to use neural networks which have a hidden layer inside them. And the number of points in the hidden layer is a variable in the neural network. So if you want to apply neural networks to your test data, then we have to first set up a table with a composition and catalytic test data results. Then we have to train the artificial neural networks. And this training means that we have to select neural networks that describe the relation between composition and catalytic test data best. And this training and selecting of the neural networks is quite time consuming. And then after we have selected the suitable network, then we want to use it to extract an optimal catalyst composition for high propene yield, or we want to use it to extract certain rules how composition is related to reactivity. So we have applied this data analysis to this dehydrogenation of propane data. We had experimental data for all catalysts that contain these elements, and that were 222 catalyst compositions. And these 222 catalyst compositions, they had more test data. And we use all the data to train different artificial neural network architecture. But all these networks had one hidden layer in common. And the architectures varied in the number of these intermediate points in the hidden layer. Then we had to do a cross-fold validation. We did a 22-fold cross-validation with this, where we always use 216 catalysts of these 226 compositions as a training set, and then the remaining 10 catalysts were used as a test set. So you train your artificial neural network function with this 216 catalysts, and then you test it again with 10 and look how it fits. And you do it 22 times and for one set of network parameters. And so if you do that, you can get an idea if you overfit your data. So this is a necessary procedure to identify if a network is suitable or not. And this is the main science behind that. So, after we have found a neural network that is appropriate for describing our data, we use it for the predicting new catalysts, and then we prepare these new catalysts and verified the prediction. And what is shown here is the experimental value and the predicted value. Predicted means predicted by the neural network. And you can see that the prediction is quite good for these examples. Although, and what is also important, we predict the catalysts of very different activities. So we selected within this network certain points at lower activity and at high activity, and we wanted to validate the network for different positions in the parameter space. And it turns out that this neural network was able to describe the propane data quite well. And you can use the artificial neural network also for visualization of your parameter space, where you have to limit yourself to a maximum of four parameters, because otherwise visualization would not be possible. And here is shown the propene yield for the vanadium, molybdenum, gallium, manganese system. And you can easily see where the region is with the highest propene yield. And another way to extract the information how a catalyst should be composed is to extract rules. And rules can even be used in higher dimensions. So when you do not, when you cannot visualize the result. What we really can do, we can be, I think this is here's which kind of rules can be extracted from the artificial neural networks. We can identify the areas with a high propene yield within this composition space. Since here is also a visualized system, we are also limited to four parameters. So here we have molybdenum, gallium, manganese, and vanadium is the rest. And then we can identify three different regions where we have a high propene yield. A propene yield high means we have above 8%, is the value selected here. And these rules were proved again by preparing new catalysts. And rule one was a certain gallium content, manganese content, and molybdenum content, and the same is true for rule two. And we checked both rules by preparing new catalysts, and there again the predicted and the experimental value are in good agreement. Let me come to here to the conclusions of my talk. First, I hope that I've shown you that the evolutionary approach with a genetic algorithm is suited for improving of catalysts and also for discovering new catalytic compositions. Then I wanted to show you, I hope I could show you that artificial neural networks can be very useful as a tool for knowledge extraction from the combinatorial data, but they can also be used to set up relationships between the catalytic performance and the material properties. They can be used to predict optimal catalytic catalyst compositions. And what I've not talked about, they can also be used to optimize the evolutionary procedure. So we had our propane data available, and we had this artificial neural network that was able to describe the propane data, and we could now run simulated evolutions. So we set up an evolutionary approach, and then we use the artificial neural network to predict the catalytic results, and thereby we could generate or come from generation to generation by only using this neural network, and we don't do catalytic tests. And with this procedure, we could easily optimize our parameters of the evolutionary approach, like the number of crossover points or the number of mutation points when we proceed from generation to generation. This is what is meant by setting up a combination of the genetic algorithm and this artificial neural network. This is then a virtual experiment, and that can be used for optimizing the whole strategy of evolutionary growth. Okay, then thank you for your attention.
Floor is open for questions.
Yeah, it was very interesting, the first part about the evolutionary theory to catalysis. I was curious, isn't it very sensitive, though, to what type of test you choose? Is there a battery of tests that rank these? It looks like it would make a difference. You might end up with a specialist versus a generalist, like a grizzly bear or a koala bear, you know. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have different rankings. So what we do is, if we do crossover, then we have a ranking by the objective function for one of the parents, and we have a random selection of the second parent. So, and we do not focus on one kind of a ranking or one kind of selection mechanism.
Yes, but but
it's
you
not
put all those catalysts in one reactor and do one test, right?
Yeah. Okay, or we
so do you do
tests.
Like two tests or three tests? Is that also, and then also play?
So we have we have normally a generation size that is compatible with the system setup. So if we have reactors with 50 channels, then we choose generation sizes of 50 or 100. And then we have to run one or two tests. But mostly, so it's not, the generation size is 50 or 100.
You mentioned the combination of your composition and performance, and in that slide you also showed deactivation as one of the components which you bring into consideration. Now, if you have a deactivating system, and obviously the various catalysts would be deactivating at different rates, how long do you typically run a set of experiments to get valid information? I'm talking from a very practical perspective.
Okay, we have one project where we run experiments up to 2 weeks in these setups. But we have not yet done an optimization, so this evolutionary optimization we have not applied to a deactivation problem until now. We have just the experience from the experiments.
Most of the examples you showed were combinations of the different elements. And of course, in the catalyst, the support is important too, and the properties of the support. So have you looked at the effect of different properties of supports, different supports, and so forth?
I was very brief with introducing this algorithm. One of the main advantages is that it's very flexible. So if we look at hydrogenation, for example, where we could use different supports, then we can set up the algorithm in such a way that we define certain groups of parameters that belong together. So we have the group of catalytic of support, where we have different supports, and they cannot exchange their genes with the composition of the active material. And then we have a group, active metal, for example, we use palladium, platinum, rhodium, so all the noble metals. And then we might also use modifiers of that. And we have different groups of elements identified by their function. And this chemical knowledge we integrate into the algorithm. And that's how it gets effective.
David, from very specific questions to more generalistic question. You obviously watch the literature and you have contacts in this area. Are you aware of any actual heterogeneous catalyst which was developed by that type of approach, which has been introduced to practice, to the industry?
I think it's too early. All these approaches are quite new. The combinatorial approaches and all, and I know just some patents from, I think it's from Spanish group and from Sinex. And also, okay, with this Ligusa approach, we had some success, but it's not running in the industry.
So this artificial neural network is a software, is commercially available, somebody in your lab developed that?
You can buy two toolboxes, so which contain different type of neural networks, and then all this training that you have to done on your own. You can buy a kind of toolbox for optimizing perhaps reactor output or something like that. So a different problem. There you can buy a complete software. But now you just can buy a routine, a collection of routines with MATLAB, or we use MATLAB as a package. And all the training you have to do on your own. And the selection of the right architecture of the network. That cannot be predicted. So if you have to use a network with one hidden layer or with two, that has to be tried.
Okay, and my understanding is that you are changing the composition of the catalyst. Just like you got some points, you do curve fitting.
Yeah.
And you generated a function for that curve.
That is true.
And then you use that curve to predict the result, right?
Yeah.
Does the curve give you some new points that has better result other than those you have done in your experiment?
A little bit better.
Okay.
So that is also because of this propane dehydrogenation, there's not a real step. So many systems are a little bit active and they produce a low yield, and then you have some systems which produce a little bit more propane, but you do not see a large change in activity. You will not have some samples that have a yield of zero and others with 100% or 90%. You're always in a small change, and so you cannot really expect to predict a function that interpolates somehow between your points to predict a maximum. Otherwise, it would not really be realistic. So you have a flat space, somehow flat space, and you can predict an optimum that is somehow above this flat space, but only a small value.
In your schematic with the three levels, you know, you had the composition, then the hidden level, and then your yield, just schematically. Now, in many cases, if you have an experimental design, I think more of process conditions, you have second and third order interactions of your primary variables. How is that taken into consideration in your hidden level?
With this is possible to describe these connected parameters with this network. So it's a neural network will always describe this. So these functions are not linear functions where you have this output connected with a linear function to this hidden layer, for example. So this is all exponential vectors, nonlinear functions inside this layer. And you have connections from one input neuron to all these hidden neurons. And so you have this combination. I think that was a good thing.
Yeah, okay. So
there's no direct connection between one parameter and one. So you have always the connection. Yeah.
Okay, so I shouldn't read the diagram too exactly. There are more interactions than what you've shown. So that would be suggested.
Here, this one. This is what you mean.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm thinking of interactions. So, for instance, if it was not composition at the lower level, but process variables,
yeah,
then there might be cross functions between them before you get to the inner layer. So, I might visualize even more than one inner layer to put in different jobs.
We use independent parameters here, but you could use also dependent.
Okay.
So this neural network approach here, I mean, is about a quantitative relationship. If something qualitative here, you know, for example, you want to predict a new element, so you can promote it.
Yeah.
So this only gives you a evolutionary change.
So with this neural networks, we only interpolate between or in this parameter space, where we have just few points in the parameter space, and these neural networks are the best approach to describe these kind of parameter spaces, because by this training you can be sure that you do not describe certain things that are not there. That's also why we do this cross-validation of the data.
But what happens if, say, you have seven elements here, and you suspect that probably some other elements are probably more important than some elements? How do you substitute those other elements?
What we have on the input layer is what is in the catalyst.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to train, or the neural network describes just the function between